I came to Pemberton chasing banality like a hound a rabbit, and found instead a lush, slow beauty so insistent and particular that it frightened me. After my initial visit to Tish to scout the lay of the land and attend the interviews Charlie had arranged for me, I think I would have backed out of the whole thing, except that by that time, Tish had found a place for Hillary and me to live. "You have to come now," she said. "You've got to get that child settled down before school starts. And you've got to settle, too." Tish was neither a fool nor a bully, and she had been a loving friend for close to 20 years. Tish Griffin, my roommate at Emory University in Atlanta, always held that I lived, moved, and had my being, as the Book of Common Prayer puts it, in flight from my father. He was a squat, roaring black Greek who kept a small grocery store in the blue-collar section of Atlanta where we lived. And from long before my birth to the day he died, he drank liquor and embarrassed my mother and me. I remember the youthful anguish that his behavior and the snickers of my schoolmates caused me. But I remember loving him, too. "It's a classic escape mechanism," Tish said to me one April night during our sophomore year. I had for a few months been going out with her boyfriend's roommate, like him, a junior at Emory Medical School. Tish had been going with Charlie Coulter so long that their wedding was as fixed in her firmament as our familiar stars. But I had only met Chris Calhoun when Charlie's old roommate flunked out and Chris moved in. I had that spring evening announced to Tish that I'd marry Chris in 3 seconds flat if he asked me. "Escape mechanism," Tish said. "Get away from Daddy as fast and far as you can. And what's further away than Chris Calhoun?" "He's not worth you. He's too pretty. He's too rich. He's like a corrupted elf or something." I snapped back. "How do you know it's not my mother I'm trying to escape?" And knew in that instant that it was true. My mother was a flower of old Mobile society, according to her earliest bedtime stories, caught in a brutalizing marriage to a Greek god gone to seed. From my earliest memory, it was as if they had a kind of mad joint custody of me. I lived half the time in his careening tenure, loving him, and half in her kingdom of cobwebs, adoring her. He frightened me sometimes, but my mother made me afraid. To this day, she will not see it. For a short period of time, I confronted her with it. "You overprotected me to the point that I thought I wasn't capable of simply living in the world," I said. "It was always, don't do that, you'll get hurt. You can't do that by yourself." "Oh, toot," she said. "I gave you the only kind of upbringing that matters in this world, the kind that makes you a lady. You can be very sure that Mr. Christopher Calhoun would never have looked at you if I let you grow up the way you say you wanted to, missy." By the time I reached college, I no longer took people home with me, both because of my father's drunkenness and my mother's by then refined Blanche Dubois act. I stuck fiercely to my studies and my sorority sisters, aping slavishly each tiny detail of dress, speech, and behavior that struck me as normal. In fact, I did not for a long time know what normality was. It was what drew me to Christopher. Much, much later, I saw that there was within me an essential, if deeply buried, appetite for outrage, for dangerous excess. But in the beginning, I knew nothing except that I wanted Chris, and he incredibly wanted me. He asked me if I would marry him, and I said yes. The first thing he said after that was, "Can I for Christ's sake touch you now?" And so the lovemaking began. There was no longer any reason for my pulling away from Chris except the real one, fear. It was my mother's longest-lived legacy to me. My fear was justified. After the first great stabbing pain as Chris entered me, I was lost, swallowed, drowned. I screamed for Chris to stop. I was utterly gone in panic. It had been this fear, then, that waited for me in my own body. Not the world's fears, pregnancy, disgrace. This one, the fear of vanishing altogether from the face of the earth. Chris did not stop. When it was done the last time, I began to cry. It was like dying. "I know," he said, grinning. "They say it is like that, when it's the best it can be." After that, we did it only once a night. But it was always something exotic and unimagined. I became what I believe is currently called a love slave, and spent the time I was not in bed with Chris turning myself into a perfect buckhead surgeon's wife. By the winter before my marriage, I was growing haggard trying to decide how to handle the matter of my parents. My father solved the problem early that spring by choking to death on vomit. He gave my mother the graceful cover of mourning in which to hide from my wedding, for she had behaved so baroquely and affectedly at the one obligatory luncheon my mother-in-law, Sally Calhoun, had given for her, that it was apparent even to her that she would not be welcome there again. My mother never held his mother against Chris. To her, he could do no wrong. After the beating started, the first thing she said was, "What did you do to make him that mad?" The shrink I found last spring told me, "You need to get away from her as much as him." "But I love her," I said, "at least half of her." "Then leave the part you hate and send letters to the half you love." "Do you want Chris to kill Hillary?" "He wouldn't hurt Hillary," I said. "He loves Hillary." "Andy," said the shrink, "he loves you. This is what Chris does when he loves." Each time it happened, he cried and begged my forgiveness. The first broken bone we explained as a fender bender. An open kitchen cabinet door got credit for the eye and cheek laceration. It seems incredible to me now, but I actually caught myself saying one morning after he had bruised my stomach and thighs so severely that I slept sitting up, "I don't think any of this would have happened if I hadn't behaved like a whore with him." But I could not take action. And then, one evening in April, Chris wheeled his Mercedes into the driveway and screeched to a stop because Stinker was lying in it. And when Stinker did not move, he simply gunned the car forward and ran over his daughter's dog. There was a flat thump and a high, anguished, endless scream from my daughter. And then nothing. "Well, Hillary, look what you made me do. Maybe now you'll learn to keep your animals out of the driveway," he said. Hillary was gone and up the stairs to her room before I could move. "Get that dog out of here and bury him someplace, Chris. And then go to the hospital or the office someplace. You can come back in 2 days because we'll be gone by then." He raised his fist and then lowered it. I did not move. I knew it was not I who deterred him, but the thought of Hillary, the daughter whom he so loved and had now wounded past his power to heal, past perhaps anyone's. And then in mid-August, two things happened. A letter came telling me that Chris was filing for divorce and suing for custody of Hillary. And Hillary found the letter on my desk and read it and took an entire bottle of children's Tylenol. The afternoon after I brought her home from the hospital, white and mute and listless, I called our attorney friend, Bill Kimbra, and made an appointment to see him the next day in his office downtown. I went into the coffee shop on the ground floor and ran into Tish Coulter. She had it out of me in 15 minutes and went to see Bill Kimbra with me, and in another hour had out of him his grim-faced assurance that the case would never see court, and that Chris would be a lucky man if I did not choose to have him jailed for assault, battery, and mental cruelty. By late afternoon, she had my promise to come the next week and at least see Pemberton. We did, and stayed 3 days, and left again. I with a job in the public relations department of Pemberton State College. On the Thursday afternoon before Labor Day, we rolled into Pemberton, Georgia, in a second-hand yellow Toyota Celica station wagon. In my files was a court order forbidding Chris to contact Hillary or me until the divorce was granted, and he had completed at least half a year of psychotherapy. We came into Pemberton itself, green and dreaming and somehow a little eerie, with its wide, quiet streets lined with the huge Baroque fantasy homes of the unimaginably rich winter people who had come here with their servants and children and horses since the closing of the last century to renew themselves and play. "It looks stuck up," Hillary said fretfully. "Well, it isn't," I said decisively. "Aunt Tish says the people here are wonderfully friendly." She turned her head to read a sign. "That says hunting season starts next week. Does that mean people can kill animals?" "I guess it does. Some kinds," I said. "I hate this place," Hillary said. And for the rest of the afternoon, she was quiet. On our first morning in Pemberton, Hillary came sobbing into my bedroom in Tish's guest house. "I heard the nightmares coming for me right outside my window. They made a horse noise, and their feet sounded not like they should." Honey, it was a bad dream. That's what a nightmare is, I soothed. Let's go look. There was nothing out a window. Tish laughed when I recounted it. She did hear horses. We're just a block from the training track and the stables, and lots of people ride their horses along the street in the morning. The street is dirt. That's why their hooves sounded funny. It's the ultimate status symbol in Pemberton to live on one of the dirt streets. It's one of the South's best-kept secrets, Pemberton is. I guess it's because the very rich have never needed anything except privacy, and there's a hideous lot of money in Pemberton, dirt roads notwithstanding. Don't knock them, by the way. Your new house is on one. I rented you the guest cottage at Pipe Dream, the old Belvedere place. It's wonderful, Andy, with stone fireplaces and porches all around, and it's cheap. It sounds perfect, Tish. Hillary will love it. It's just that Pemberton is not your ordinary little southern town, is it? It's very exotic. My God, it's so rich. It doesn't seem to me to be a normal town. I must have paled because she leaned over and pressed my hand and said, "There's nothing here to scare you. Pemberton's rich, but very comfortable and unassuming. Come on, Andy. Get Hillary and we'll do the driving tour, and then we'll go out to lunch at the inn." From the beginning, when Tish nosed her mud-spattered blazer into the streets of Pemberton, I was lulled with charm. Pemberton dreamed in a well of deep green as cool as a secret sea. Fine old oaks, some hung with scarves of gray moss, vaulted over the streets and lined long driveways. The Pemberton Inn was a rambling, deep-roofed clapboard skirted with stone verandas. Tish pulled her blazer in beside a low cream Jaguar and tooted her horn lightly. The Jaguar's doors opened on either side, and Charlie and another man peered out. "Not bad for a country obstetrician," I said, and he laughed. "Andy, this is Carter Devereaux. Carter, meet Andy Calhoun. Tish is in my oldest joint friend." "I've been looking forward to meeting her," the second man said. His smile was direct and sweet, like a child's. The five of us walked into the inn. Inside, the big, cool lounge was paneled in handsome old carved oak. Hunting prints and equestrian paintings were everywhere. We were shown to a table. "Carter is one of the best estate planners for horse owners in the South," Tish said fondly, "as well as being one of the best polo players and best steeplechasers." "Is there anything to do in Pemberton that doesn't have to do with horses?" I said quickly. "Lots of dogs," Charlie said. "Hunting dogs, mainly. They're finishing up the Southern Terrier trials over at the track tomorrow. Carter's got a couple of terriers competing." "What kind of dogs are they?" Hillary's small silver voice said. Carter smiled at her. "Jack Russell's. He'll come out to the track tomorrow and bring your mother. I'll introduce you." It was a pleasant lunch. People came by and welcomed me and Hillary to Pemberton. The talk turned to horses and hunting. Hunting season did indeed open the coming week. I hated the talk for Hillary's sake, but there was nothing I could say to her in front of all these people. "You really will come to the trials tomorrow, won't you?" Carter Devereaux said to me and to Hillary. "There's some horses around the stables about your size." The sun came out in Hillary's eyes again, and so I nodded yes. "I didn't realize this was such big hunt country," I said to Tish as she pulled out of the lot. "Oh, Lord, yes. Some of the best hunting is out around the big Silver River swamp. Some of the world's great private hunting preserves are here. The big plantations. Charlie and Carter hunt at one of them, King's Oak, and it's owned by a Pemberton man, Clay Dabney. He's a darling. It's his old family place, and he and his son have hung on to it. Clay rents part of the woods to a paper company. A hunt at one of the plantations is something to see. You'll be invited to at least one." The next morning, Hillary, in a pair of Katie Coulter's outcast jodhpurs and boots, looked highborn and horsey and lovely, and knew it. The three big Pemberton tracks lay in the woods to the west of Palmetto Street. The stables were lovely in the blue early morning light. I loved the names. Dogwood, Runaway, Hand to Mouth. Charlie drove the Jaguar through the gates of Runaway. Its green and peach sign said Belvedere. "We'll meet Carter here," Charlie said. "He's got part interest in one of Pat Dabney's horses."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.